Okay, so today on numerical methods, as maybe always to give you an orientation, we are discussing the numerical method called Monte Carlo method. We are discussing how to generate other distributions from sequences of uniform distributed random drawings. Okay, and the first method we discussed was the inversion of the distribution function, and for that we had to actually define what is the inverse of the distribution function, because the distribution function can be is monotone but not strictly monotone, and for that we defined some generalized version, which you see here in the picture. So whenever you have say some area of non-uniqueness, like here, we take just the infimum of this set. And we could actually then show this lemma, we could prove this lemma, that if you have given the inverse, this generalized inverse of the distribution function, then from a uniform random variable, so from a sequence of uniform drawings, you can generate an F distributed random variable X by applying the inverse here. Okay, and we already used this in the code for say one example. So we already used this in the code for one example for the normal distribution. For the normal distribution, there is no closed form for the inverse of the distribution function, but we had some libraries, some implementations that provided sufficiently good, hopefully, approximations. And we took a look at combining this inversion with several methods of generating sequences of uniform random numbers. One was the pseudo random number generator Mears and Twister, and we also tried it with a quasi random number generator, the van der Korpus sequence. And in this session we then generated some plots. So let me just start this here. So we generated the van der Korpus sequence, and we generated a sequence from Mears and Twister. Okay, and on the left here you see the uniform sampling, a histogram of the uniform sampling. You see it's a pseudo random number generator, so there is some randomness here still, which you also then see in the transformed distribution. It's a little bit rough, while the quasi random number generator is almost equidistributed, so it has equidistant sampling points. It's much smoother, and hence the transformation is also very smooth and nice. But as a small reminder, recall that this randomness here is in higher dimensions, maybe also a feature, and higher dimensional quasi random number generators are not so easy. So this is an example in one dimension. And then actually there was a very nice question at the end of the last lecture. So after we have finished it, there was a small discussion on how do these inversions, the implementations, behave on some more special floating point numbers, on some limit cases. And we already had this in the script. So there was some warning here. So it's actually important to check the behavior of the transformation in combination with your specific random number generator. So in the context of the random number generator you use. Yeah. So for example, some random number generators generate the value zero. Yeah. So wall sequence, the first element is zero, and some implementation of the ICDF map this then to minus infinity, which is from a mathematical point of view maybe good. From an implementation point of view, it's maybe not so nice. So that was our last lecture, and I have another example here on the slide where you immediately see that this issue, if you are not aware of it, can result in surprising results, which then keep you maybe busy finding the bug. Yeah? So if you consider the Monte Carlo valuation, so of a financial product, we discussed this in our motivational section last time. So then you have a payoff function, which describes the future value of the option. And here I have a put option. So it's actually the maximum of K minus S, the stock. So the maximum of K minus S. And so this payoff function looks like this. Oops. Let's draw a little bit nicer here. Yeah. So this is your underlying stock. This is the K. This is the payoff we have. So our put option pays you nothing if you are above the K. Okay. And then it pays you a linear profile, say, with, if you look from the left, with negative slope, because it is a minus S. Okay. And if you look at this under the Bachelier model, so now I also take a slightly different model, the Bachelier model. So in the Bachelier model, the future value of the stock is not log normal distributed. Yeah, so you see there's no log here involved. It is just normal distributed. So it's possible that you have negative value for this stock. Yeah. So maybe for a stock, it's not so reasonable to have this, but recall there are negative interest rates. Yeah. Or for example, recently there was a negative value for the oil price. Yeah. So it's not unreasonable to have such a model. And in this model, if you now do what we just described as our numerical method, so you have a uniform sampling U, you calculate from this uniform the normal distributed sampling Z, then if your sequence has a zero here, it will be mapped to Z equals minus infinity if this implementation is like this. Yeah? So not all implementations do this. And then in your payoff function, since minus infinity in Z will lead you to a minus infinity in S, will lead you to a minus infinity in V, you will get the average, and minus infinity plus any other number which is not infinity or not a number will then lead you minus infinity. Okay, and together with this minus here in front, it will be then a plus infinity in the value. Yeah? So there was this minus here. So we will get a plus infinity value for this option, yeah, which is just a numerical issue, yeah, which is not the correct value. So, and to complete this discussion, for this example, I would like to do another small code exercise with you. Let's compare some different implementation of the inverse of the distribution function of the normal distribution for some specific floating point numbers. Recall that we had this first session on computer arithmetic, so we know that there are some boundary numbers, and actually how do these functions behave at these numbers? And is it maybe important to treat these numbers in a special way? So these were our tests here, which generated the plots I just comment them out. And I like to create a new small test function here. Let's call this, actually I have two different implementation. The the implementation from Apache Common Math. So this is Apache Common Math 3, which we could test. Okay. And I will then test another one. And let's test it for a specific number of our uniform distributed sampling. Yeah. So let's test it for U, or let's say call it P, the probability, yeah, which we invert. Yeah. P equals 0. Yeah? So what does this implementation for P equals 0? So, and I create some test now here. Okay, so first let's do some print. So maybe I print first some horizontal line. So because we will have more tests, more test output, and then let's print some headline, what we are actually doing here. So this is testing Apache Common Math implementation for P. So let's print the P. So P is equal to P. So first, from this uniform distributed number, I would calculate some normal distributed doing the inversion method. Yeah? So, okay, for Apache Common Math, I need to create an object. This is normal distribution here, normal from Apache Common Math. So this is the object you need to create. I have a new here. Okay, and then you can ask the object to perform some stuff like give me the inverse cumulative probability of this number P. Okay, so then let's print what he's creating. This is X of P. Okay, so X of P. So let's make it nice here. X of P. I print this out. So then what happens if I take this X and I plug it into the distribution function? Then I would expect to get again the P. Okay, so let's try this. Double P, let's call it P from X. This is normal cumulative probability from X. Okay, so this is now my P of X of P. Yeah. And our expectation is that this is again P. Yeah. So we do a round trip, F of F inverse of P. Yeah. Should be P. So this is the P from X. And what else can we do? So if we go back to our Black-Scholes model, then you saw that there is the logarithm of the stock is normal distributed. So it means the stock itself is the exponential of a normal distribution. Maybe I could try also to calculate the exponential. Yeah? So exponential from X is just exponential of X. So what happens if I plug this into a Black-Scholes model? So let's also print this. So this is exponential of X. Okay, and let's align the output a little bit. So that is now our little test. Yeah. So we have a uniform distributed input. From the uniform, we create a normal distributed. And from the normal, we recreate a uniform. So we do some kind of round trip. Okay, so let's test this now with zero. Okay, and you see that we have for the uniform equal to zero, Apache Common Mass gives us a minus infinity for the normal one. If you plug in the minus infinity again and would like to recreate the P, we get zero again, which is correct, which is nice. Yeah. So, and for the exponential of x, we get a zero. Okay. So let's do the same test now with some other implementation. Let's do the test first with p equals one. Yeah, the other limited case. Let's do the test with p equals one. So maybe I have to do it like this. Okay, so here you see that p equals one will be mapped to plus infinity. If you plug in plus infinity to f, you get back one. But if you use this plus infinity in your Black-Scholes model, you will get an infinity, of course. Yeah? E to the x with infinity gives you infinity. Okay, so now try a different implementation. I create another test, ICDF implementation. And there is in the FinMath library the Vitura implementation. Yeah, so one version of Vitura. Let's test this one. Yeah, so let's create here this method. And I just copy here the same test code, which we did for the other implementation. Okay, and I just change these two parts here. So for the inverse normal, I have to keep this. For the inverse cumulative probability, I now use a different function. So let's use normal distribution from this library here, and there is inverse cumulative normal distribution Vitura, yeah, which is an implementation that was actually mentioned here in our script, yeah, so which you can read here in this paper. And this implementation is accurate up to machine precision, actually claimed in this paper. so I also have to change here my title. Okay, and but for the cumulative probability function, so for the F, I still use Apache Common Mass. Yeah, actually, it looks as if this is a bad idea. Yeah, because I'm actually mixing two implementations. Yeah, from two different libraries. So why should one library designer actually consider that his inverse is fitting well to the other one? But if this is the true or good implementation of the ICDF or CDF for the normal distribution, then maybe they should work together. So I use these two. And let's place this test here underneath here for zero and also for one. And we had this already, I believe, yesterday, yeah, in the discussion. Okay, so the Vitura implementation behaves strangely different for this limit case zero. Yeah? So the P equal to zero is actually mapped to X being zero. and x being 0 is the point which belongs to 1/2. Yeah, so just in between. So if we are here in our exercise, yeah, so we have here the uniform distributed random numbers. So let's draw this here. Okay, so there's the 0 here, the 1 here, the 1/2 here, so some numbers. And these are transformed to the normal distributed random numbers. So the 1/2 is transformed to the, say, 0. Okay, and for also for the Apache, it's transformed to 0. Okay, the Apache moves the 0 to actually this special value here, minus 1/2, and moves the 1 to this special, minus infinity, and the 1 to the special value plus infinity, and here in between you have some transformation, yeah, which maybe look like this, okay, the distribution, and the Ventura one transforms here this value just to the 0. Okay, so which is maybe okay, because 0 is a value that appears quite often. Yeah, so actually 0 itself does not appear often, more often than other values, but many values are close to 0. Yeah, so which is just maybe from an implementation view, okay. But if you do this, actually the Ventura implementation will never generate an infinity. Yeah? It just generates some other dummy value. Okay, so you might have mixed feelings about this. Maybe it's better to use the implementation which is from the mathematical point of view more correct, but treat the special point 0 and 1 in your uniform random number generator, so ensure that they do not destroy your calculation. That's maybe a better approach. So now let's test some other special values. So recall that there was the value which we call the machine precision. Yeah. So what was this? Actually, this value was 2 to the power of minus 53 for floating point double numbers. Yeah. So recall floating point double numbers in a normalized representation. Yeah, it was 1 plus c divided by 2 to the power of p. Yeah. So the denormalized numbers, we call the denormalized numbers. Oh no, it was the normalized one. So it was 1 plus 2 to the c, a constant c, 2 to the power of p. Okay, so the machine precision was 2 to the power of p, and the p was 53. So that's the reason. Yeah. So the thing which we can distinguish is 1 divided by 2 to the power of p. So let's test this number. Yeah. So it's a very small number. Okay, so for this test, so let's move it here. Okay, so what do we find? So this is our known machine precision, 10 to the minus 16. Yeah. So our uniform distributed random number is very small, very close to zero. The normal distributed number that corresponds to this is minus 8. If we retransform the minus 8 to the uniform using the distribution function, we get the same number. Okay, that's nice. If we would use this x, this minus 8 in a Black-Scholes formula, it would just give you a small value for a stock, yeah, which is okay. And the other implementation has the same behavior. Very nice. But now recall that this is the machine precision. So actually this is the smallest number that can be for which 1 plus epsilon is different from 1. Yeah? So for which you can distinguish 1 from 1 plus epsilon. Yeah? So this is the machine precision. But in the denormalized numbers, actually we could create even smaller numbers. So if we are close to 0, we can create much smaller numbers. There was the double min value. Yeah. So double min value is here, if you look, the constant holding the smallest positive non-zero value of type double. And this is actually 2 to the power of minus 1,074, yeah, which is now in the range of the denormalized numbers, which are much smaller. Now let's check the two implementations on this number. Okay, so here Apache Common Math for this number, which is in base 10, it is 5 times 10 to the minus 324. Yeah? For this small number, it will report a minus infinity. So somehow we have rounding to minus infinity, which will give us, of course, if we plug it back, a zero. Yeah? Used in the exponential, it's a 0.0. Okay, our Ventura implementation reports that this number should be mapped to a minus 38. And if I plug this minus 38 now into the Apache implementation, actually I get back this very small number. Okay, so actually this implementation behaves very well also for numbers which are in this denormalized range, yeah, in this range of very small numbers. Okay, so another thing you could check is what happens if you are close to one. So now you know from the machine precision thing, yeah, so you cannot get as close to one as you can get to zero. Yeah? The closest I can get to one is one minus 2 to the power of minus 53, because otherwise the number cannot be distinguished. Yeah? So you see one minus 2 to the power of minus 53 is 0.99999. It's mapped now to plus 8, inverted. It's back, mapped back, yeah, and in the exponential, it's just a reasonable number. Okay, so and also just to let you know, this is the machine precision. So if you have 2 to the power of minus 54, yeah, then you will get again a 1, yeah, and then he cannot distinguish it from 1. Okay, so you see that actually the region where these implementation work very well, yeah, is from 2 to the power of minus 53 to 1 minus 2 to the power of minus 53. Yeah? So between these two numbers, both implementations behave nicely. Actually, we observed that the Ventura implementation also behaves nicely for even smaller numbers. So how can we judge this now in context of our random number generator? And there is one last remark for this session. So recall that the pseudo random number generator, the way he is generating the random number is as following. Yeah. So most generators, they first generate an integer, and this integer is between 0 included and 2 to the power of p excluded. And then they use a floating point transformation by just dividing the integer k by 2 to the power of p. So actually, our random number generator would never generate this value. The only value he is generating is all equidistributed floating point numbers between this number and that number. So 1 divided by 2 to the power of p, 2 divided by 2 to the power of p, and so on. And this is the last one. And in addition, he generates 0. So if you just exclude the 0, yeah, then you have a nice equidistributed uniform distribution, yeah, on the floating point numbers. And actually, both implementations then work very well. Yeah? So the reason that this implementation here has a special treatment for the 0 is just to fix this in case the developer forgot to exclude the 0 from the transformation to the normal distributed numbers. And as a last remark here, if you like to have a look at this implementation here, the inverse cumulative, using this approximation. So you can just see it here. Yeah? And as I explained, it's a piecewise rational. So it's a piecewise. So there are certain intervals where some checks are performed or some decisions are performed. And it's a piecewise rational, which means it is the ratio of polynomials. So this is just a polynomial here divided by a different polynomial. And it's a piecewise rational with huge polynomials. Yeah. So here up to order 8. Yeah. So, so C0 to C7. Yeah. Divided by here D1 to D7. And with some coefficients, yeah. So the task is to find here the good coefficients. Okay, so that was a small excursion in this question, yeah. So that you have to be maybe a bit careful to compare the transformation of normals to of uniforms to normals and the generation of the uniforms. Okay. So now, generating drawings of other distributions, I would like to discuss another example. So my next example is an exponential distributed random variable, yeah, which is also very important in applications, yeah, for example, for mathematical finance. So first, let's review the definition. Yeah. So if you have given some parameter lambda, yeah, so the intensity, then the exponential distributed random variable is given by the following, and let's just state the distribution function. So the following distribution function f, and f is 1 minus the exponential of minus lambda times x for x larger than 0, otherwise it is 0. So let's create a small plot here. Yeah, so if this is your x here in your distribution function, then I can draw first for you maybe exponential minus lambda x. So exponential minus x, yeah, looks like this. For 0, we have a 1. And then it is converging to 0, exponential minus x. So actually this line here is a 1. And then we actually take 1 minus this. So let's write this here. This is just exponential, or let's write it with an e. So e minus lambda x. Okay, and then we take a minus of this. So this means that there is a certain slope here where we start here, and then we slowly approach the one. Yeah. So this is here our function f. This is f of x. Okay, so for this one, we have a very nice distribution function. So if we like to apply our method, inverse of the distribution function, we can just calculate the inverse. So you have u, your uniform u is f of x is 1 minus exponential lambda x. So then you move the 1 to the other side. So minus 1 multiply with minus 1. You have 1 minus u is exponential minus lambda x. So then you take the logarithm. So you have log 1 minus u is minus lambda x. And then you divide by minus lambda, and you have that the transformation is x, the exponential distributed is given by minus 1 divided by lambda, logarithm of 1 minus u, where u is uniform. Okay, so that is a very nice function, and I can immediately create an exponential distributed random variable. Before I discuss this maybe in more details, and also we find another numerical method of generating generalizations of this, I would like to discuss an interpretation of this distribution, and also maybe you can view this as a motivation for where this is relevant in mathematical finance. So the exponential distribution is often used, yeah, or is the classical thing to model default times. Yeah, so it's used in the modeling of default times. So default is some event, some failure, for example, failure to pay. Yeah, so a payment is not performed, but it's also used to model failure of devices. Yeah, your device is failing. That is to say, so there is some event, the default event, whatever it is, and this default event occurs at a stochastic time, so we do not know when it occurs. So let's say now, today, is zero, so it occurs either now in zero or at a future time, so it maps the events a little omega to zero to infinity, and the probability that the default happens before a given time little t, so tau is the default time, probability that tau happens before little t is exponential distributed, so is 1 minus the exponential of minus lambda. Yeah, so this is the distribution function. Okay, so I can calculate the opposite event, yeah, the probability that we do not default before little t. So actually we could say that this is the probability that we survive, and this is just 1 minus the other probability, so it is actually exponential lambda t. Okay, so this is the so-called survival probability. Exponential lambda t is the survival probability, the probability that we survive up to time little t. Okay, and this distribution actually follows from a strikingly simple assumption, namely that the trigger which leads to the event, yeah, so the failure to pay, the failure of your device, is memoryless. So the trigger doesn't care of the past, so it doesn't care of how much time has passed. Yeah, it only depends on the time interval you observe. So the trigger is memoryless. What does this mean? It means that if you have two times, So let T1 be smaller than T2. So T1 is before T2. Then the probability to survive up to T2, conditional that you already know you survived up to T1, is just the probability to survive an interval of this length. Yeah. So actually, it does not depend on where you look at this interval. So it does not depend where T1 starts. Yeah, it just depends on the length of this interval. Okay, so this is the probability to survive up to T2. Given we survived up to T1. Okay, so this assumption, which is maybe a natural assumption, immediately leads to this distribution. So why does this happen? So for the conditional probability, the definition or one way to express the conditional probability is the probability that we survive T2 conditional to T1, probability to survive, probability of the event A conditional to B is the intersection of the two events divided by the probability of the event B. Yeah? So you restrict everything to your condition space. Okay. So that's actually just the definition here of conditional. It's just a restriction. Yeah, so we restrict us here to some subset of events, to all the events on our condition, and we then take the intersection of our event A with this space here. So now, but here for the times, which we had, the intersection of tau being larger than T2 and tau being larger than T1 is just tau being larger than T2. Yeah? So this the first one is the interval from T1 to infinity. The second one is the interval from T2 to infinity. So actually this here on the top, because we are looking at times, is just the probability that tau is larger than T2. Okay, so then I can actually just express the probability that we are larger than T2 by the conditional probability multiplied with the probability being larger than T1. Yeah, so I just multiply this on the other side here. Okay, so this is times the conditional. Okay, and now for the conditional, I use this number 7. Yeah, using the number 7. Oops. So I use that the conditional, my assumption, my conditional just depends on the length of the interval. Yeah, so it's just the probability that tau is larger than T2 minus T1. Okay, so you have some kind of, from this assumption, some kind of multiplicative structure. Yeah, the probability to survive a very lengthy interval is the probability to survive a shorter interval multiplied with the probability to survive the remainder. Okay, and just the length of the remainder. So if we have this, then we can actually decompose our timeline into time discrete steps. So this here is maybe capital T. So now I take a look at small intervals. So this here is 1 divided by T. This is 2 divided by T, and so on. This here is n minus 1 divided by t, and the last one is n Oh, sorry, this is 1 divided by n times t. Let's fix this. So I can discretize my timeline here into small intervals. So this is 1 divided by n times t here. And then this is maybe 2t divided by n, and so on. Okay. And this one here is n minus 1 divided by n times t, and the last one is t. Okay, so you can do this. And from this multiplicative rule here, I then get that the probability to survive up to time capital T is just the product of all those small intervals here. Okay, so I have the product from I equals 1 to n. And every interval has the same length. The interval is of length t divided by n. So interval here is the length t divided by n. And actually you see that in the product there's no I. All intervals are the same. So actually I can just write this is the probability to survive a small interval t divided by n to the power of n. N times multiplication to the power of n. So we have this line here. Okay, so now let's do a small transformation to this. Actually, if you have something to the power of something, so I have here the probability to survive a small interval to the power of n. Then you can write this as the exponential of the logarithm of the logarithm of what is here in the base. So this, where's my pen? Okay. In with a logarithm to the power of n is then multiplied with n and get the exponential from it. So I just rewrote this. Then the divided by the multiplied by n is written maybe a little bit more complicated. So the divided by n is just t divided by t divided by n. Okay, so this is my still my n. So t divided by t divided by n is still my n, and here is still the logarithm of the probability to survive a small interval. Okay, and now I know that this holds for all n. So it's just I introduced one time discretization, it holds for all n. And now let's take a look at the limit n to infinity of this quantity, which is the only quantity which depends on the n. So let's take the limit n to infinity of this thing here. And let's call this limit minus lambda. Okay, so our minus lambda is this. So actually lambda is minus the limit of the logarithm to survive a small interval divided by the interval length. So the logarithm to survive up to time t divided by t when the interval length, the t, goes to 0. So that's what we have here. So you see that this is just the finite difference of the derivative of p greater than t differentiated with respect to t in 0. Okay, so actually you see that this is just, you have actually a minus here. P probability of tau greater than T is 1 minus the distribution function. Yeah, probability of tau less than equal T is the distribution function. Okay, so this is the derivative of 1 minus the distribution function. So minus of this is just the derivative of the distribution function at 0. So actually, we now even have a nice interpretation for our lambda. Yeah? So recall here, I had this plot, and actually, this slope here, the slope which we have here, is just lambda. Yeah? So lambda determines the slope that is used to exit from the zero. Yeah? So if lambda is larger, you will faster approach the one, yeah? The probability one, the probability to default immediately. So lambda somehow controls how fast your device fails or how fast default occurs. Okay, so now we have a very intuitive, very nice interpretation of this distribution. So the distribution just comes from here the assumption that the event is memoryless. Yeah? So just this assumption, which immediately gives us this distribution. Yeah. So you see here we have exponential of minus lambda t. Yeah, exponential of minus lambda t. So this is the inverse of the distribution function. So this tau here is exponential distributed. In the computer and in many applications, we look at discretized versions of this. If you have a discretized version of this, it looks like this. So you have some timeline here, and then you jump from one time point to the next time point. Yeah? And in between, it can happen that you default. So in between, it can happen that you have this default event. If not, you continue. Yeah, but then in between, it can also happen that you default. So default is the terminating event here. And the probability to survive here is 1 minus p. And the 1 minus p is just the exponential of minus lambda delta t, where this here is just the delta t. Okay, so this is now the discretized version. Yeah, so actually the thing actually which we used exactly in our derivation. So this here. Okay. This is a very important, yeah, also very important distribution. And as I already mentioned, you can do inversion of the distribution function very nicely of this. Yeah, so we have that f of x is 1 minus exponential minus lambda x. So if we would use the inverse of the distribution function, it's that we generate tau. Yeah, so maybe I use the letter tau because it is nicer. Associated with the interpretation of time. So how do we calculate now a default time from a uniform sampling? So we take minus 1 divided by lambda, the logarithm of 1 minus u. And maybe we can also check the limit cases, u equals 0, u equal 1. What happens in these limit cases? So for u equal 0, I have logarithm of 1, which is 0. So tau is 0. So this means we have default immediately. Okay, I'm sorry. We have default. And for u equals 1, the tau is the logarithm of 0, which is the minus infinity, then multiplied with minus 1 gives us, so minus 1 divided by lambda gives us plus infinity, so which is, we never default. And now, in this case, actually having a floating point double infinity would be perfectly okay. But if you check, yeah, so we always consider a little bit the implementation in the computer. Yeah, so the check in the computer T is less or equal tau. Yeah, for T. Finite, yeah, floating point number, and tau is double infinity. Yeah, so this is true. Always true. Yeah. So you can actually make comparison with infinity, and the computer will tell you that if you have some finite number and you compare this finite number with double infinity with a less or equal, then this is true. So this is true. So it would be okay if our algorithm generates plus infinity. Yeah. So if you just use it in a comparison, do we have default or not? Yeah. Then this is maybe okay. So that was another example for the inversion of the distribution function. Yeah. Maybe a very easy one, but the application is to some extent important.